So these two things are married together. The prayer of faith, which is absolute confidence in the Lord's ability, and in his name, which is absolute conformity to the Lord's will. I know you can. I may not know you will. Living truth.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of the Spirit, washed in his blood. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And all is at rest. I am my Savior. I'm happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. Yeah, this is my story. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior. All the day long, and all the day long,
praise my Jesus.
I'm gonna praise
my Jesus.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith.
I'd like to personally invite you to join Hillary and myself for for a wonderful and rich experience in the land of Israel in November 2016. We're calling this trip Awaken 2016 Israel. Hilary and I will teach at a two-day haven of reflection in a private venue right on the shore of Lake Galilee. Don't miss this opportunity. Please join Hilary, me, and the Living Truth family on this exciting journey.
To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Awaken 2016 Israel, it's your time.
The book of James reminds us not to merely listen to the word, but to do what it says. Today's message is called, What to Do About Our Troubles.
Let me turn you this morning to the book of James and chapter 5. We've been looking into James for a number of weeks. This is our eighth, and it will need to be our final study in the book of James. One of the most frustrating things about being a preacher and a pastor is deciding what to leave out, unless you spend a whole year in a book like this. But I don't think that's fair, because then you miss other aspects of Scripture it's important for us to look at. Now, I'm going to miss out some of the things we will read this morning, but I want to focus in on what seems to me to be the important issues. So let me read from James chapter 5 and verse 13, where James says, if any of you is in trouble, he should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he'll be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crop. Well, I'm going to stop reading there. There is a couple of verses left to end the book. But there are three injunctions in verse 13, 14, and 15 that I want to focus what I have to say this morning on. Three questions he asks in verse 13, is any one of you in trouble? No, probably a lot of us will say, yeah, I am. And he tells us what to do. Is any one of you happy? Is his second question in the latter part of verse 13. And I hope a few of you might be. Some of you look as though you might not be. Some of you might be. Is any of you sick? Is his third question. Maybe you wouldn't be here if you were. You'd be at home. But some of you may be feeling a little bit that way. And he says, if you're in trouble, if you're happy, if you're in sick, I've got some instructions to share with you. First of all, then, is any one of you in trouble? Trouble, of course, is part and parcel of life. It's easy to talk a little bit slickly about trouble and wrap it all up with little answers and say, this is how we should understand it, and then move on to the next thing. And I'm very conscious of that when I was preparing this. Some of us probably here this morning are experiencing bereavement. Some of us, sickness, maybe ongoing disability. Maybe some of us are experiencing trouble in our marriage or in our family life or at work or issues that just don't go away. You long to go away. We all have our troubles. We all have our heartaches. And we don't need simplistic explanations. The key to what James writes here, though, is he says, is any one of you in trouble? He should pray. A little bit earlier in verse 10, 11, he says, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. Now, we didn't read those verses. We're not looking at them particularly, but he's talking there about suffering, and the key words he uses is patience and perseverance. He names Job in particular as an example of this. Our troubles don't just evaporate. We pray, they don't just disappear from the scene. But we find in that situation the endurance to be patient and to persevere. But a little later in verse 16, if we pray, he says that the prayer of the righteous man is powerful and effective. Now, that seems to be a key to the problem. And we say, well, if that's the key, it's the prayer of the righteous man that is powerful and effective. No wonder my prayers are ineffective because I'm not righteous. What we need to do is get a sign-up list of everybody in this church who thinks they're righteous and get them to pray for everybody else, and then maybe we'll get somewhere. But what does it mean to be righteous? Well, righteousness in the New Testament does not mean perfect. What it does mean is forgiven. Forgiven of our sin and united with Christ. And so as a result, Paul talks a lot about this, we are clothed in his righteousness. So the person who is powerful in their prayer, a righteous man is powerful in his prayer, says James, is the person who's forgiven, who knows their natural state is a mess, but they've been forgiven, they've been united to Christ, born again of the Holy Spirit, and are clothed in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, he gives an example in the next verse from the Old Testament. He says in verse 17, giving an example of Elijah, Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. So here's Elijah, a man of prayer, and he was just like us, is what James says. But when you read the story of Elijah, you say, I'm not so sure he was just like us. I mean, he was a prophet. In fact, he was a super prophet, one of the few prophets in the Bible to perform miracles. Saw a lot of miracles. He was one of the stars of the Old Testament, and he appears on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus, Moses on one side, Elijah on the other. And James, you say he was a man just like us. He doesn't sound very just like us. He came on the scene in Kings 17, and he came before the king Ahab, and this is what he said to him. And this was the king whose word was law. He said, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives whom I serve, there'll be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word. And there wasn't any rain for the next few years except at his word. This doesn't sound like a man just like me. I mean, I don't go up and say that to folks. And then he went into hiding, and God miraculously fed Elijah with ravens. That doesn't sound just like us, does it? And then he met a woman who was in total poverty, had only a little jar of oil left, and he gave her that little jar and said it would never, ever run out as long as she needed oil, and it didn't. That doesn't sound like a man just like us. And then he found it, came across a dead boy, and he laid his body on the corpse of this boy and did it 3 times, and the boy came to life. That doesn't sound like a man just like us. And his most famous thing is that he was in contest with the prophets of Baal and challenged them to build an altar. And if Baal is God, he will ignite the altar and Elijah would build an altar, and if God is God, he will ignite the altar, it'll burn up. And you remember, the Baals tried their best and cut themselves, and nothing happened. Elijah said, God, here it is, and the fire fell. That doesn't sound like a man just like us. But that, of course, is only part of the story. Because after he had seen the prophets of Baal defeated, Elijah went into a dark valley of depression and said, I am left. Do you know why? Because he was a man just like us. When he went and spoke boldly to King Ahab and courageously, Ahab's wife Jezebel appeared on the scene and said she would kill Elijah. And he was afraid and ran for his life. Do you know why? Because Elijah was a man just like us. One moment he was courageous, the next moment he was cowardly. Do you know why? Because he was a man just like us. One moment he was full of faith, next moment he was full of failure. Do you know why? He was a man just like us. And so James is saying, you know, it is absolutely true that Elijah was a man of prayer who saw things happen, but not because he was born with some silver spoon in his mouth, but because he was an ordinary man just like us. He learned to relate everything in his life to God, and God intervened in his life. But there's nothing special intrinsically about Elijah. And so he says, if you're in trouble, pray, and it is the prayer of a righteous man who avails much, that is powerful, but the prayer of a righteous man is the prayer of a forgiven person who, like every other ordinary person, Elijah's an example, gets his fits of depression, his fits of excitement, and he's here one day and there tomorrow and vacillates between the two, but is saying, God, in my depression, in my frustration, in my failure, I'm just asking you to come into this situation. And then says James, see what happens. Won't all be good, won't all be rosy, but God will work. And so be patient, that's his other word. Be patient, patient. God is bringing something about even in our troubles. Now, this is one of the things where I wish we could spend the whole session on this, because there's a lot of implications to it, but we can't. Second thing he says is, if anyone is happy, verse 13, let him sing songs of praise. So in times of pressure, go to God in prayer. In times of pleasure, go to God in praise. My mother used to say when I was a kid, don't forget to say please and thank you. Prayer is saying please. Praise is saying thank you. Praise is different to worship, as you probably realize. Worship is acknowledging who God is. Praise is acknowledging what God has done. And we say, thank you for this, thank you for that. When life's going well, if anyone's happy, don't take it for granted. Sing songs of praise and put the gratitude and put the credit where it is due. Give it back to God. Now again, no time for more. We could spend a session on talking about that, because I want to give time to the third aspect, which has been controversial within the Christian church, where he asks the question, is one of you sick? What do? If your answer is yes. Let me read you again what he said. Verse 14, is any of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he'll be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. So here are the elders praying for somebody who's sick, anointing them with oil, praying in the name of the Lord, and the man is raised up. Now, this question of healing has divided Christendom, especially in the last century, probably more than in earlier centuries. And the polarization takes place over the issue. There are those who say God will heal you, and there are those who say God won't heal you. There are those who say God can heal you, those who say God can't heal you. Those who say God does heal, and those who say God doesn't heal. Now, without going into this too long, I think both of those extremes we'll understand to be wrong. To say God will heal is evidently not true, because he doesn't in many instances. I'll give you some examples in the scripture of that in a moment. To say God won't heal is evidently not true, because he has and he does. So let me look at this statement as carefully as we can. There are seven elements in these few verses. And I think looking at these elements one by one will help us, I think, get what I hope is a balanced picture. There's a sick person, number one. There are the elders of the church, number two. There is oil, number three, that is anointed with. There is the prayer of faith, number four. There is the name of the Lord, which is number five. There is the confession of sin, which is number six. And there is the man being raised up, which is number seven. So I want to look at these one by one, and more time on some than the other. First of all, then, we have the sick person. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders. What kind of sickness is James referring to? And it is evidently not a trivial illness. It's enough to make him bedridden and not well enough to go to the elders, but sick enough to ask the elders to come to him. That scenario certainly suggests to us, here's a man who is bedridden through his illness. Another reason for saying he's bedridden is that he invites the elders of the church to pray over him. That is an unusual term. It doesn't exist anywhere else in the Bible. Normally in the Bible, you pray for somebody. In this instance, they pray over them. Why? Another evidence, he is bedridden, and they come, surround his bed, and they pray over him in that physical sense of being over him. So this seems not to be the normal aches and pains, or you stubbed your toe on the way into church this morning and you need a bit of help. This is something more serious and something that debilitates a person significantly. Secondly, the elders. And when you're sick, you should call the elders of the church to pray over him. Now, elders does not mean olders. It's not a chronological term. And the New Testament elder are those who lead the affairs of the church. When Paul wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy 5, verse 17, he refers to the elders who direct the affairs of the church. Now, in the small country church I grew up in, we only had about 30, 40 people on a good day. And we had a few elders, can't remember exactly how many, but basically any mature spiritual male, because that was the understanding that they had about eldership. Elders, therefore, would include those who are pastors, many of those who are on the staff in some form of leadership. It would involve the board of the church. It would involve, in our instance, the members of our legal incorporation, which is known as PMI, People's Ministries, Inc. And their job, amongst others, is to elect board members each year, who in turn then appoint the senior staff and delegate to them the daily ministries of this church, whilst they remain the guardians of our legal and financial obligations, as well as the guardians of our spiritual function. Now, that in a nutshell is how the People's Church is organized. But There are other people who play an eldership role, leaders of life groups, for instance, leaders of particular ministries, whether it's men's ministry, women's ministries, whether it's children, whether it's leading. They all fulfill what is included in that role that we can generally call as being elders. So this is calling people of spiritual maturity and spiritual experience to come and pray. That's the second element in the narrative here. The third element is that he should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil. Third element is oil. Now, this has been seen in different ways. Why oil? What is the virtue of the oil? There are basically three positions held within the Christian church. There are those who hold it to be sacramental, those who hold it to be medicinal, and those who hold it to be symbolic. Those who hold it to be sacramental would see some divine efficacy in the oil itself. There are parts of Christendom that value sacramentalism. The bread of communion is not just bread, it becomes the body of Jesus. The wine becomes the blood of Jesus. The water in which someone is baptized becomes the means of imparting life, so that person becomes a child of God. And that is current within aspects of Christendom. Now, we are not a church that is strong on sacramentalism, for good reason. So that's one anyway. The second is that this oil is seen as medicinal. Oil was a medicine, certainly in James's day. Remember the Good Samaritan who found a man beaten up, bleeding, dying on the side of the road? And he went to him, and it tells us that he bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Why? Because oil and wine had medicinal properties. Paul told Timothy, drink some wine because of his stomach, and therefore there was medicinal value in that. So some have seen this as being, well, it was basic medicines in those days, but what that's saying is, get the man into medical care, and the oil symbolizes that. Third position is that this is symbolic. In other words, the oil is not of substance in itself. It is symbolic of something else. There are many symbols used in Scripture. Bread is a symbol of the body of Jesus. Wine, a symbol of his blood. Water, a symbol in baptism of cleansing and uniting to Christ. If you know your Bible very well at all, and I said to you this morning, what does oil represent in the Scripture? You would come back to me very quickly, the Holy Spirit. Because again and again, oil is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. So priests and kings were anointed with oil in the Old Testament scriptures, symbolic of the Holy Spirit being the only grounds on which they're going to be able to fulfill their calling as priest or king. Now, my personal view on this is that it is symbolic. That there's no virtue in the oil in itself. You don't have to say, well, which kind of oil do you use here? Do you use olive oil? Do you use engine oil? I mean, what do you do? It's purely symbolic. I mean, you could actually use Coca-Cola and it would still be symbolic if that was of any use, but don't get worried about that. But it's purely symbolic. And it becomes an aid to faith. It becomes representative that it is the Holy Spirit who you are looking to in this situation. And this is the symbol of that. Fourth thing, fourth element here, is that when they've anointed him with oil in the name of the Lord, verse 15 says, and the prayer of faith will make the sick person well, the Lord will raise him up. This is one reason why I think the oil is symbolic, is because the actual power that'll raise him up is the prayer of faith. Now, again, a big question, of course, is what does this mean? If you say the prayer of faith means as long as you believe it, he will be healed, then by extension, all sickness may therefore be healed in this way. And there are those who believe that. The only problem for them, and it's a bigger problem for them than it is for us, is it doesn't actually work in the way they'd like it to. Anyone who will say that as long as you believe, God will heal you, knows fine well it doesn't happen that way. Even though they probably see more people healed than the rest of us who don't pray believingly. But to understand this, let me put it on the background of the healing teaching generally of the New Testament. There are some remarkable healings, as you know, in the New Testament. Jesus, for instance, Matthew 8:16, one example. With a word, he healed all their sick. The crowd was brought to him and he healed them all. The disciples were sent out in Matthew 10 and told to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. And they came back and reported later exactly what you said happened. Peter, in Acts, for instance, in chapter 5, verse 15, it says, people brought the sick onto the streets and laid them on beds and mats. At least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick to those tormented by evil spirits, and all of them were healed. And this is remarkable. This is Peter's shadow falling on people. He didn't have much to do at midday, but late afternoon, early evening, he had a brilliant ministry. He's walked down the street and the shadow goes, 12 feet. That's what it says, remarkable. Paul had an extraordinary experience too in Acts 19. In Ephesus, it says, God did extraordinary miracles through Paul so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick and their illnesses were cured and evil spirits left them. Remarkable. Taking handkerchiefs from Paul and touching the sick. If you took my handkerchief, you'd make him sick. The reverse effect. But here the people healed. This is remarkable. But there are many cases of people not being healed too. And just at a glance. And we know, for instance, Jesus did not heal everyone, though he could have done. Sometimes he did, but when he went to the pool of Bethesda, he singled out one man, and there was lots of people in the pool of Bethesda. The others remained unhealed. Paul writes about himself in Galatians 4, as you know, it was because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. Even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. So I ended up in Galatia because I was sick, and I was so sick it was a trial to you, he says. He didn't pull out his own hanky, so let me see if this will do it. I mean, he was sick. It wasn't just one day he was sick. It was a trial. A burden to the people. We don't know what it was because he doesn't tell us, but it was possibly his eyesight, because the next verse, he says, I can testify that if you could have done so, you would have torn out your eyes and given them to me. So it looks very likely that his problem had to do with his eyes. Maybe he was getting increasingly blind, as there's other evidence of that in Paul. But some of his team got sick as well, Epaphroditus. In Philippians 2, Paul writes in verse 26, he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard that he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and he almost died. Now, this wasn't some passing little cold. It was life-threatening and he almost died. Another of Paul's team left Trophimus sick in Miletus. I had to leave him behind because he was sick. Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy 5:23, stop drinking only water and use a little wine because of your stomach and your frequent illnesses. So Timothy had a stomach problem. Timothy's tummy. But not just that, he says, your frequent illnesses. He was of a frail constitution, obviously. Timothy, you're always getting sick. Take some good medicine. Drink wine. Make sure no one's looking, but drink it. No. I'm showing you this, and Paul himself, by the way, had his thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan. He doesn't tell us what it is, except it debilitated him enormously. And I pleaded with God 3 times, take it away. And God said, no. I have a vested interest in keeping you in this difficult position because my strength is made perfect in your weakness. So many were healed in the Bible. Many were equally not healed in the Bible. And even those who were used to perform miracles, like Paul, did not themselves always become the recipients of miraculous healing. So how do we understand this? It's a basic rule of thumb to say Scripture always means what it says. It does. We don't pass over a verse and I don't like this verse, I'll stick it out somewhere. The question then always is, what exactly does it say? And I think the next element is a key phrase in this. Let me read you verse 14 again. He shall call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. Now, here's a key. It's not just passing. I think it's the key. You anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And then you pray in faith. What does it mean to say in the name of the Lord? It's a very familiar thing to us. We pray in the name of Jesus. You know, most of us finish our prayers with that kind of phrase. What it actually means to pray in the name of the Lord is we pray under the authority of the Lord and in the will of the Lord. I'll show you why those two things are contained here. Under his authority and in accordance with his will. Jesus made some remarkable promises about praying in his name. I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there am I with them. What does that mean? John 14, 13, and I will do whatever you ask in my name. Whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. John 14, verse 14, you may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. John 15, 16, the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. John 16, 23, I tell you the truth, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. These are fairly emphatic statements. If you are praying in the name of Jesus, I'll do it, said Jesus. Now, this isn't just a formula for getting effective prayer. In his name has some meaning. It means, as I've just said, under his authority and according to his will. Let me illustrate this. Occasionally, I get a letter in the mail that asks me for a specific amount of money. And I don't like letters like that, but I always send it. I send the money they've asked me for. The reason is not because I'm generous, but because on the top of the envelope, it says Canadian Revenue Agency. Some years they send me money too, by the way, which is nicer. And this letter is saying, in the name of the government of Canada and the authority of the government, I'm not asking you to give this money. I'm telling you. Now, if you wrote to me a letter asking me for money, I probably wouldn't give you any. So don't try it. Because your letter would have no authority. You're simply appealing to my kindness, which I hope I have a bit of. If you wrote on top of the letter, Canadian Revenue Agency, you know, to beef it up a bit, you would be taking their name in vain. And that would be a criminal act. You cannot send letters headed Canadian Revenue Agency, you owe me $2,000. That's a criminal act. Therefore, alongside ask in my name and I'll do whatever you ask, is the prohibition, do not take the Lord's name in vain. It's a criminal act. Equivalent. That, of course, is one of the Ten Commandments. So, therefore, what it means is that to pray in his name is not because we have initiated this and we're hoping God will conform, but the complete reverse. God has initiated this and we are conforming. It's in his name, not in our name, not in the name of the church. It's in his name. This is under his authority. This is according to his will. This is because he told us to do it. And to ask in his name is to ask in his will. Those two things come together. And 1 John 5:14 says, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. There's similar statements earlier. If we ask anything in his name, he hears us. Here he says, according to his will, because they are interchangeable. When we know his will, we can come with confidence and say, in his name, I know. The things we read in the scripture, we know are the will of God. We can pray in the name of Jesus. Why? Because you said it. We can't take verses out of context. I've heard it many times. And here's an obscure verse in the Old Testament somewhere, and we apply it to some present situation, and we say, I'm praying this in the name of Jesus, you know, because this is what he said. You know, God will lean out of heaven and say, that is not what I said. So we have to be sure, what is it that he said? And then he leads us subjectively too. He gives a sense of conviction. But we're subject to the will of God. Now I know those who feel that if you pray, if it's your will, that's a kind of cop-out. Remember some years ago, I was visiting a hospital with two or three other people, and we prayed for a lady who I knew who was sick. And I prayed that God would heal her and raise her up if it was his will. And on the way out to the parking lot, one of the other people in the group said to me, that was not a prayer of faith you prayed this afternoon. I said, why'd you say that? Because you prayed that God would heal her if it is his will. I said, well, what's the problem with that? She said, well, if she is not healed, you will say it's not the will of God. I said, correct. She said, no, that is not praying in faith. Praying in faith is saying you will be without any doubt about the outcome at all in your mind. Well, if you've had some revelation of that, you can be so, you can do that. But actually, it is not lack of faith to pray if it's your will. It is actually faith. It is saying, God, I've got my perspective, I have my ideas, I have my preferences, but I trust you to know exactly what you're doing, so your will be done. We need to be careful of insisting our own way with God, because earlier in this passage, James 4 verse 3, in the previous chapter, he says, when you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. So he's just told in the last chapter, you pray and nothing happens, you don't get anything, and the reason is this, you're interested in what you want. You want it for your pleasures. And so now next chapter, he says, if you pray, something will happen. Why? Because the whole basis of the prayer has changed. It's not, Lord, this is what I want. It's okay to say this is what I want, but subject it to his will. But now in chapter 5, he says things will happen if it's in his name, because he has already, it's his agenda, it's not your agenda now, and he's already revealed this to you. You need to be very careful on assisting our own way with God, because he might give it, and that could be the worst thing that ever happened to you. In my early teens, there was a man in that area who was extremely sick with leukemia, and our church gathered together one night, brought him in on an evening, and prayed for him, anointed with him with oil, and prayed that God would heal him. And before we prayed, he said, I wanted to say something. I appreciate so much the fact you all want to pray for me, and you are praying for me. But I just want to say this. There's a verse that troubles me in the scripture that says in Psalm 106, God gave them their request, but sent leanness to their soul. He said, I don't want to bring leanness to my soul or anybody else's soul by living. So I want you to subject your praying to the will of God alone. I was very, very challenged by that as a young man. That surely is what James is saying here, that the prayer of faith in the name of the Lord, that is under the authority of the Lord, raise the person up, and the prayer of faith may have to be if it's your will in the name of the Lord, because he hasn't shown it to you. You're not clear about that. So these two things are married together. The prayer of faith, which is absolute confidence in the Lord's ability, and in his name, which is absolute conformity to the Lord's will. I know you can. I may not know you will. But if you will, you will, because I know you can. That's the combination of those two things. And then confessing sin, we won't talk about that, was the next thing. Confess the sin, you know, bring your body and your soul together and get your soul right as well. And then he says, the Lord will raise him up. The prayer offered in faith in verse 15 will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. There are two ways to read that. First is simply that he's made well and he's made healthy again. And I can tell you anecdotal stories of people who've been prayed for in this way and they have been made well. So that's one option. That's the obvious physical way. John Stott points out a very interesting thing, that this term, he'll be raised up, is used elsewhere in the New Testament, but only when speaking of the resurrection. Be raised up. And so he suggests that this could mean that this man on his deathbed is getting right with God, he's confessing his sins, and he is going to be raised up at the resurrection. One doesn't exclude the other. God may heal a person physically, but they will one day be healed fully. And that's why, going back to the early part of this chapter, be patient, persevere, because this life is not what it's all about. This world is not just our home. We are passing through. There is a better, a fuller, a greater day to come. And all our tears will be wiped away, all our ailments will be over, all our sickness will have gone, all our feeble bodies will have been replaced with a new body. In the meantime, let's pray in the name of the Lord. God may heal, but let's cling to that eternal fact. To be absent from the body is to be in the best position you have ever been. And this could include a reference to that. So the overall section is this: if you're in trouble, pray. If you are happy, praise. If you're sick, call the elders to pray, anoint with oil, and to pray in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith will raise him up. And don't forget, confess your sins, he's saying as well. Well, that's an invitation to all of us to do business with God when we're in trouble, when we're happy, when we're sick, to do business with God and bring him in with all his resources and strength and power, and persevere, be patient. The big picture is not about today. Other things are being worked out as well in our lives. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you this morning for your word, for its truth, for its power. Thank you for the Holy Spirit, who, having inspired your word, is the key person in implementing it by both teaching us its truth, leading us in its path, and empowering us for its fruit. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that we will, whatever our circumstances, keep our eyes firmly fixed upon Jesus. We will trust you for whatever you want to allow to happen in our lives, whatever end result you're bringing about. The perseverance of Job, as James speaks, deliver us from many impatience that says, let's get this over with. I commit you, any who are suffering here this morning, any who have shed tears this week because of things in their lives that have gone wrong, grief over a child maybe, we pray, Lord, you'll help us to come close to you in prayer and trust. And where it's been a good week, help us not to forget to say thank you and to praise you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Join us next week as Charles Price begins a series called Faith, Hope, and Love, right here on Living Truth.
God, in my frustration, in my failure, I'm just asking you to come into this situation. So in times of pressure, go to God in prayer. In times of pleasure, go to God in praise.
The book of James reminds us not to merely listen to the word, but to do what it says. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca.
So, do you know what James really says about all of this? He says, just do it. Just do it.
Many times in my childhood, we traveled so far, and by nightfall, how weary I'd grow, and Father's arms would slip around me, and gently he'd say, my child, we're going home, for I'm going home, I'm going home.
got a glimpse of that heavenly land. Praise God, I am going home. But now twilight is fading, and the day soon it shall end. Oh, I get homesick the farther I roam.